In this lesson, we'll take a look at PI system security, specifically allowing connections from remote nodes to the PI data archive. End users who will be retrieving data from the PI system are almost always on a machine separate from the PI data archive, like on their own laptop, for example. By default, the PI data archive grants access to only applications running on the machine itself. So, user access to PI system resources must be understood and taken care of in order to allow the rest of the organization to take advantage of the PI system. During the beginning PI system planning stage, I brought up how the PI server integrates the best with the Windows Active Directory security design. In the PI server, data and information primarily reside in either the PI data archive or the PI AF server. With the PI AF server, security is relatively easy. You take any type of Active Directory entity, whether it's an individual or a group, and associate it with resources in PI AF. We haven't gone over any specifics of what really lives in the PI AF server, but consider this one example, which involves creating a hierarchy that represents your specific process. Here, it's a top-level category called pumps, with the actual pumps listed underneath. The neat thing about PI AF is that we can attach PI points to these pumps. So users can essentially view PI point values through this PI AF framework. Now, as an admin, you can control who can see this pump structure in its entirety, or maybe have certain users see some pumps and not others. In addition, you can select a group of users and give them access to add or delete pumps. The point to make here is that you only need to consider the actual Active Directory user or group and the PI AF resource you're concerned with. Now, let's move over to resources inside the PI data archive. Like security for the PI AF server, you need to take note of the specific Active Directory users or groups and the resource, whether it's to read PI point values or to change settings in the tuning parameters. But there are two distinct steps in between. The first is a PI mapping or PI trust. The second is a PI identity. Think of the first as a mechanism for authenticating who you say you are, while the second assists with authorizing what resources you have access to. Let's start with PI mappings and PI trusts. These again are used to authenticate the client, verifying who they say they are. During the creation of a PI mapping, the two important parameters are the Active Directory user or group and the PI identity, which is a collection of PI system permissions. We'll go over PI identities later in this video. When a user attempts to connect to the PI data archive, their user and groups that they belong to will be verified by the PI data archive. If a PI mapping is found for this individual, they will be associated with the specified PI identity. Note, there could be multiple PI mappings for one person, in the scenario that they're a part of multiple Active Directory groups. This is fine. They'll be given each associated PI identity, receiving a combination of all the resource privileges. On the other hand, there are also PI trusts. These aren't integrated to Windows Active Directory, as PI trusts are used mainly for allowing specific machines and applications access to the PI data archive. The best example is for PI interfaces running on remote nodes. You'd create a PI trust that associates the machine via machine name or IP address and the PI interface with the required PI data archive resources via PI identity. In summary, OSIsoft recommends to reserve PI trusts only for unattended applications, like a PI interface, while user access should be granted by PI mappings. Next is the authorization stage, where the correct permissions are assigned for the now authenticated user. Here is where PI identities come into play. Remember that a successful connection via a PI mapping or PI trust associates a PI identity with the user or computer. PI identities are associated with a set of configurable permissions to resources. For example, there can be a PI identity called PI System Administrator that has access to read and write permissions on every PI data archive resource. Users who are associated with this PI identity can create new PI points, add or unregister PI archives, change tuning parameters, and even edit security for other users. On the other hand, there can be a more restrictive PI identity, like guest, with only read access to a small subset of PI points. One tip, it's advisable to map one Active Directory group with one PI identity. Instead of mapping multiple Active Directory users with the same PI identity. This way, the entire Active Directory group has a sort of pre-configured access to PI system resources, and you need to only add an Active Directory user to this Active Directory group to immediately grant him or her permissions on the PI data archive. We'll take a look at a diagram that illustrates all of this in one complete view, but quickly, let's go over two more topics. When we talk about PI identities and granting them access to resources, access control lists come into play. They look like this. The syntax is the PI identity name first, and then their allowable permissions, either read or write. With PI identities separated by this vertical bar. Besides PI points, there are plenty of other PI data archive resources. Most of them are found in what's called the database security table. Here, you grant access to data structures on a global level, unlike the individual PI point bases we've talked about so far. For example, security for reading or modifying PI trusts as a whole can be set on the PI trust table. We see here that PI admin, PI admins, and PI world are listed by default. The first two have both read and write privileges. You can tell by the R and the W. While the third PI world is present, but doesn't have any permissions. Since there isn't an R or W associated with it. This is effectively the same as not even listing PI world at all, but these are just defaults. So in your own system, take care to state explicitly which PI identities should be given access. Other common database tables besides PI trust include PI modules for controlling global access to the module database and the PI point table for top level access to PI points. Back when I went over settings that aren't synced between PI collective members, I brought up the PI firewall, the first level of security to the PI data archive. While it does exactly as advertised, which is to either allow or block incoming IP addresses or hostnames, it's not highly advisable to utilize this feature in a production level network. There are very likely more sophisticated corporate firewalls present throughout the network, maintained by a dedicated IT group, that can do exactly what the PI firewall can do, and much more. Use these corporate firewalls to protect traffic between PI system nodes. By default, the PI firewall contains only one entry configured to allow all IP addresses, essentially relieving it of its duties. The second topic concerns the PI license subsystem. This is one of many components of the PI data archive, and it's designed to work with the PI server license to enforce any restrictions provided in the license file. Lastly, there's a section in PI SMT called Security Settings, which shows this slider for changing PI data archive security on a wide scale. For example, a client tool like PI Process Book, which uses the PI SDK protocol, can use a PI trust to authenticate on the PI data archive. But remember, PI trusts should in general be reserved for unattended applications, like PI interfaces, while real people should access the PI data archive via PI mappings. by sliding this bar up to SDK trusts are disabled, the user using Pi process book that depends on a Pi trust will not be allowed in. But in many environments, some exceptions are bound to be made. So OSIsoft recommends to set this to at least explicit login disabled. Explicit logins used to be the common way to connect to the Pi data archive using a dedicated Pi system username and password. So while it may seem ideal to maybe set this slider to the top level for maximum security, it's not practical and in some cases not possible. Now, here is the big picture of the connection logic between an end user and the Pi data archive. Let's say the user opens Pi System Management Tools, or Pi SMT, and wants to view data for a Pi point. The first point of contact is the Pi firewall. But in our case, all IP addresses are allowed, so we get through this and then reach the Pi license subsystem. This subsystem will let the user through, even if for some reason Pi SMT isn't explicitly allowed by the license file. Now, assume the user's machine is configured to check for available Pi trusts first. But nope. Let's say there isn't a Pi trust configured for his machine. It'll then move on to Pi mappings, which take into account the user's Active Directory username. And here, there is a Pi mapping, which grants a specific Pi identity to the user. And finally, let's assume the Pi identity has been configured to read data for all Pi points in the Pi data archive, and then finally reaches the Pi point itself. The user will now be able to see data for the Pi points he searches for. In this lesson, we went over how applications on remote nodes authenticate and are authorized on the Pi server. Pi AF security is the simpler version, since you only need to be concerned with the end user and whatever Pi AF resource is being asked for. But on the Pi data archive, there is also Pi mappings and Pi trusts, as well as Pi identities that must be factored in. In the next few lessons, we'll exercise this knowledge by allowing connections to the Pi Data Archive on PiServe 1.